Hey guys, welcome back to the shop for another week of Saturday Night Special. So in today's episode, I got a good little mix up for you. We're going to begin with a small machining project. I had a customer in town that had an RC helicopter and needed a little custom shaft made for this, and found me, come to me, and asked me if I could make this. So this was a little small job that I knocked out. So we're gonna share the machining of this little small shaft for this. I believe it was for some type of drone, okay? And then I've also got some updates on the property here, and we've got the new garage building completed. That was done this week. I've got some time-lapse video of that project, you know, of it being built. I've got some walk-around video of why it was being built, and then I've got some follow-up after it was finished showing the completed project. And just really excited to see that project finally done and got a new storage building here on the property. So just really excited to share that with you this week. So why don't we go ahead and just dive right in and get right to it, okay? Got this little shaft that I got a machine today. This just come in today, and this is a little rush job that I'm going to do for a gentleman that found me. He went into another shop and they couldn't help him today because they asked if he could get this done either today or by tomorrow, because he's from out of town. He's actually from Texas, and he's going back home tomorrow evening. And he said he could not find anybody where he's from out there in Texas to help him machine this. So he brought it with him because he's here on vacation, because last time he was here, he actually had a shop here in town do some machine work, but nobody could help him get it done this time. So they sent them to me, and I decided I was going to go ahead and help them get this done. So this is a little shaft for, he called it a drone helicopter, and that's really all I know about it. And other than he's done some modifications to the body, and he needs this area of the shaft here to be 3/4 inch taller, okay, or longer, should you say. All right, this is a metric shaft. I believe it was 10 millimeter. Okay, so it's a 10 millimeter shaft there on the journals. There is a shoulder there in between that we have to machine into it. That looks like about a 12 millimeter diameter shoulder there. So we're going to add 3/4 length here, or about, you know, 20 millimeters. Other than that, everything's going to be the same, the journal diameters. This is a hollow shaft, but he says that didn't matter. We're not going to worry about that. The holes here, we'll just go from the end and put them in the same location from the end. And then this side right here, everything is just going to be the same. And then he actually brought a piece of material here. This is probably just some 1/2 inch 1018 cold rolled. And he supplied the material, so we'll just cut a piece off this and use that and machine a shaft. I'm going to use the 6-jaw. And I mounted it back over here on the Victor. I want to use it because of the high speeds that I can get with it. And I went ahead and dialed it in and adjusted it, and I've got it repeating within 0.5 thousandths. So we got one side faced and center drilled, and what we'll do is I'll just measure it and we'll face this side. I'll pull it out, and then I'll just continue to face it until we get the end-to-end length where we need it. Faced and center drilled on each end there, plus our extra, you know, 3/4 inch added to it. So this journal here is the one that we're adding a length, and I've already measured with calipers, and it's exactly 3 inches long. So we're just going to start with this one. So it'll be 3 3/4. We'll just go ahead and turn that. We'll turn this one, get it finished out, and then what we'll do is we'll flip it around. And then we'll finish that side there. All right, slight change of plans here. So this piece of material that was given to me is actually bent pretty bad. I didn't realize that. I took the piece of stock, cut it, you know, and I chucked it way up in here. All right, but once you pull it out, and it doesn't matter where you pull it, but you can see that it's bent pretty good there. I've already got the ends cut. It's just gonna be an aggravation to try to use that. See that right there? It's best to start with a nice straight piece of stock, and usually cold roll is nice and straight. I've got this 1/2 inch piece of, this is drill rod right here, and It's the perfect length to make that right there. This is just a drop that I had on the shelf. And drill rod is normally nice and straight too. See that? That's how it's supposed to be. So I'm gonna go ahead and just repeat what I did. It won't take me but 5 minutes. And I'm gonna face the ends there and re-drill the centers. And then we'll go and we'll start turning this piece right here. We're gonna go ahead and put to use a new tool that I recently got in from Edge Technologies while we're working on the shaft right here. And so I've been working with them for quite a while now, several months, and trying to help them size up this tool that they've been developing. And this is a carriage indicator, and they've got this for sale on their website now in a standard size that fits a lot of your more smaller standard size lathes. And they've been working on a couple prototypes for my lathes for the Victor and the Monarch. And this one right here, they've got it marked for Victor. So this is a larger size. So they're working on, I believe what they're calling an XL version. So an extra large version to fit larger ways. So what this is a clamp. It's a cantilever style clamp that clamps onto the bedways and holds the dial indicator, okay? So instead of your traditional magback style indicator that clamps, that sticks to the ways, this one clamps on to the V-ways, which is clamping force. And then they got this cool little arm right here that attaches to the end of the indicator, so you can loosen this bolt and then move this around if you need to, you know, get this into a different position. So again, this one is more of a prototype sizing called the XL, but they do have this for sale on their website. I believe it's somewhere around, I want to say like $60 for this version. It comes with the indicator there as well. Got the carriage set where I want. Let's see how it feels. All right, so there it is clamped up. Feels pretty rigid. And we do have a 1-inch travel indicator on there. Let's see how it goes setting a zero. So I want to go ahead and I'm going to bring the needle to the 9 o'clock position and just go ahead and clamp it in right there. This little arm here is in a good spot already, right there where it's at. We're going to loosen the bezel. Let's go ahead and rotate this guy around. Make sure we're tight. There we go. Okay. All right, so let's see how that works. We'll put a little use on this thing. Benefit to this right here, well, there's a couple benefits. One, you're not sticking magnets there to the waist, so you're not, you know, rubbing on this. This is an aluminum body, so that's an added benefit right there. Two is there's plenty of times where I've had chips come slinging around here and actually pull this indicator off or move it, things like that. So this being clamped on there should be less susceptible to being moved than you know, the traditional magnet style. I was just using a piece of high speed steel there. I believe that's some Rex 95 that I had already ground up previously. Just really not a lot of room to get in there with my insert tooling. I don't have any small insert tools, so we're just going to use high speed. I can see right there that I'm not going to clear that center on my next end feed, so what we're going to do is just leave everything right where it's at, but I'm going to go ahead and take this tool out. I'm going to go over to the grinder and I'm going to grind this corner off to relieve that, to give it a little bit of clearance. It looks like that'll work right there. Got our journal turned where we want it. I'm just going to chamfer the end of it using that carbide. All right, this side is finished, turned. Got a nice polish on there and I got it right on size. The old one measured 0.3, 92 and a half. And we've got that one right on it. So now we can go ahead and chuck this side. We'll put our center in it to hold it and go ahead and turn this side there as well. Put a little witness mark there. This very end of the shaft measures out at 9 millimeters, but it mics 0.353 is what it finishes at. It's 25 thousandths, slowed the feed rate down to 5 thousandths. If you keep it oiled, it does a nice curly chip like that right there. If you let it cut dry, it's when it tries to string on you. And it's nice and smooth. All right, we got our last shoulder distance there stepped off, which is 2 3/4 inches. That leaves this shoulder right there in the center. It's actually a 16th long is what that is. It's kind of funny they use inch lengths there, but the journal sizes are millimeters. So maybe it's because of bearings that these are going on. So I don't know, but we got that right. We've got our zero here. So touch that right there, just like so. Our finished cut here, taking 10 thousandths, running 700 RPM, 5 thousandths feed rate. That tool's doing a really good job on this drill rod. It's got a nice smooth finish there. Just taking that shoulder down to 12 millimeters now. Got this one polished. Everything is on size. All right, there's our original shaft, our extra 3/4 length. Everything's looking good there. So now what we gotta do is just go to the mill. About to put our hole there. And then we got two holes that are 90 degrees apart there on this opposite end. I'm gonna use the super spacer to drill the two holes here on this end, since they're rotated 90 degrees out. And I would use a collet block, but with this being metric, I actually don't have any metric collets to hold on this diameter there, so it'd be a little tricky to hold that. I'm just going to use the spacer here. It'll do a good job. We'll just put it in right there, and then I'll put a jack underneath this to support it. All right, that's the location of our first hole. I got this jack here that's it's well supported up there. It's not going to try to tilt on me. So we're going to run it up in there. I got it sitting on some 1-2-3 blocks. And then we can raise this up. Just like that, just to support it. go ahead and rotate it 90 degrees. And now I'm going to go ahead and finish it, moving it down the right length. We're at 430. Now we want 705 for the second hole. Probably just use my Noga to deburr those right there. And all this, there was nothing set up on the mill. To make this lineup easier, I'll probably go ahead and just set my Kurt vise back up here. That way we can push it down on the parallel and then level out the hole nice and square to get these holes square with the other side. This is a little deburr tool that I love using. It does such a nice job and so quickly. All right, we've got her pushed down in there, pushed down on the parallels. And then you see we got the drill bit through here, and I've eyeball leveled it the best I can, and I think that's going to be well suited for what this is. Usually things like this, it's just more of a symmetrical thing. I don't think there's any kind of functionality on these holes being perfectly exactly 90 degrees on one end to the other. And usually whenever you eyeball them like that, it's going to be well within the specs of what needs to be on there for those holes to be aligned. So, like I said, just pushed it down square, and we've got that one in line. Just using the half function on the DRO up here. That's going to be our hole location. So I am going to push these parallels back out of the way so that they don't hit, but I'm going to put it right on the tip of that shaft there. Hopefully I've got it clamped tight enough that that little drill is not going to try to push that shaft down. Just making a divot with the center drill, and then we'll use our drill bit to go ahead and drill the hole. And there it is. Well, there we go. We got that one finished up. Turned out pretty good. Looks pretty nice. That drill rod is pretty good material to use for small parts like this, small pieces. I was trying to get those holes lined up to see that everything is lined up like it should be. So everything's the same. We just added our 3/4 inch to this end right there. That was what the customer wanted. And so we're good to go. I'm gonna go ahead and give him a call now and let him know he can come and pick this up. So I hope you guys enjoyed. We'll see you on the next video. Thought I'd give you a little update on the concrete cleaning. Doing some more around there on the front of the shop, the slab there. So we just come around here this morning and I cleaned this one again because the building is supposed to be here tomorrow, and we had a big heavy rainfall over the weekend and all the stuff in the tree came down and stained the concrete again. Not bad, but you know, there was spots all over it. So I used my cleaner, my 30 seconds, and then I used the surface cleaner and went over it one more time, and it's looking good. And I do want to put a sealer down on this, but it's probably going to have to go down after the building is up because the guys are going to be here tomorrow. So I don't think I got time to do a sealer. I've got other work I got to get done today as well. So once the building is up, I'll see about getting some sealer and sealing the concrete. I was going to point out this back here. This was the area that had the dark spot from the muriatic acid, so I got that up as well. And right there, I don't know, it might be hard to see. I can see how that muriatic acid really etched that concrete whenever I put it straight down on that concrete. So I would suggest staying away from that stuff and just use some kind of
cleaner design for concrete and mold and mildew and that kind of stuff. So anyway, that's that there. Thought I'd give you some highlights of this now. So I'm going to start working on this shop slab out here. I'm going to go ahead and at least get a couple squares of this clean. I'm going to have to move all that stuff over later, but we're going to go ahead and I want to get a little bit of this done. And I started with the two garage doors. I sprayed those down with my cleaner and hosed them off. So I wanted to point this out. I had a lot of guys mention one of these too. So this is what they call a turbo cleaner. And I bought this off Amazon at the same time that I got that surface cleaner. It's just this didn't arrive in time of the other video. And this works pretty good too. This sort of oscillates, or it rotates like this as it sprays. So it puts out a nice fan motion. And these are really good for uneven surfaces, just such as that door, brick, masonry, curbs, anything like that. Maybe your vinyl siding on the side of your house. I was using it to hit the corners here, the corners of the building. I cleaned the doors with it. You can see right there where I hit it with the turbo nozzle. And here's one more little helpful tip as well. I bought one of these. This is a little hose extension. This guy right here. See this? You pick one of those up off Amazon as well, and you can just leave this on your pressure washer, and it gets where you screw your hose in, the spigot part, it gets it out here where it's easy to access. And I think this was like $10 off Amazon. Here's the other tip I learned. Keep your 40 degree spray nozzle in your pocket, and when you get through doing some cleaning, you want to hose it off using this. Really get all that dirt off of it that you just been blowing around on the surface. Of course, you want to do this when you're done. I'm just kind of giving you guys a little shot, seeing what the concrete looks like. But first little area. You can see this side's dried now. Looks a whole lot better. But you can kind of compare to this side right there that hasn't been cleaned yet. Real happy with the results. Looking forward to getting this side done and getting the yellow look off the new concrete there. We just got to get all that stuff moved back over. I'll do that another day. Got plenty of work to get done. Well, we got some good news and some upsetting news. The good news is the contractor is here one day early to start getting the building put up. There you can see the roll-up door. This is some of the trim. And what they're doing is that they're just unloading all their stuff right now. I told them they could use that lot behind me because the landowners over there usually don't mind. And they're just getting everything unloaded right now. I'm glad I got the concrete. It was just today that I cleaned the concrete. So apparently I messed the order up, and he told me that it's not vertical metal like on this right here at the shop, that it's going to be horizontal metal down the side. And I wasn't aware of that whenever I ordered it. Thought that I ordered vertical siding, but we're just going to roll with it. It's here, it's bought, so we're going to get it done. They're getting these guys anchored down now. You can see there's the redhead there. They just got this one anchored. And he was pointing out to me just a little while ago that the slab is not perfectly square. So they had to make sure the building was squared so that it would fit on the slab properly. But it varies a couple inches on the side. Nice to see this finally going together. Looks a lot bigger once the structure starts going up. Look at that, guys. We got a completed metal garage building. I'm very excited to see this happening, man. How cool is that? I've been planning and wanting this for a very long time now. A couple years I've been, you know, putting this in the plans, and I finally made it happen. For a little while there, I wasn't even sure if I was gonna do this. And we decided to go ahead and pull the trigger, and I've been saving my money and wanting to get this done. And I've been wanting this. This originally had started because I wanted a garage here on the property to put my car in a while back when I had the Challenger. I wanted a garage to park my car in, but I got rid of the car, you know, I got the truck, and this is actually gonna be a storage building now to replace my little shed, this little white shed right here. This This used to be a nice little building a long time ago, the way the property was laid out, but I don't like this shed. It's got a lot of wood rot down low, and I want to get rid of this because I want a full driveway through here. So my plan is to tear this shed down and get rid of it, and I want to finish the driveway from up there where the driveway's at, and we want to finish the driveway and come all the way through here and come all the way back to meet the garage right there. That way I can a lot more easily be able to bring things back here as well. I'm hoping maybe one day I'll have a forklift as well, so I'll be able to use that around here on the slab and out here to be able to load things. But get rid of this shed. But this is going to be my storage building for any of the things that I'm storing. You know, we all have things that we store. All you guys probably have garages and buildings, and you've got yard equipment, tools, you know, things like coolers and all that kind of stuff that you put in a garage. I want it in here in a more organized fashion, and of course more space to be able to store that. I've also got some tooling and things like that in here in the shop that's kind of stacked up in here, so I'm going to be putting some of those things that's in the shop is going to be coming out here into this storage building. Just really excited to have this. So excited to have this. And I've already given a big thanks to my Patreon supporters, but I'm going to thank you guys again, the Patreon guys. You've been a big help with this project right here. I really appreciate it. So this building right here is this is a Carolina Carports fully enclosed metal building, and this is the catalog size for this one is a 24 by 26. The actual footprint is 24 foot wide, 25 foot deep. They include 1 foot because of the overhangs up there. And looking at this right here, this was the concrete spacing, that this little pad right here was not put in the right place. But the guy has centered the building on the concrete slab this way, and it's perfectly spaced front to back on the edge of the concrete. But the slab itself wasn't perfectly square. It was out about 3 inches out of square. So they've got it centered on there. That's how I wanted it was centered. But once I get the concrete done, once we get some concrete driveway put in here, I'll have it come over here, and we'll just pull this pad out, and I'll have this redone to kind of match up with the doors there. So this isn't an issue to me. So let's go ahead and take a peek inside. Look at that. Nice, big, brand new, clean, pretty building. I love it. So I went with 10 foot wall height right here. So these are 10 foot walls. Of course, you got your bracing. This is part of the engineering that has to go into the building right there. That's part of the your structure and your wind load. And they did seal the bottom beams, by the way. These are sealed down here on the bottom for moisture and water, that kind of stuff. That's what I mean there. So we got the roll-up door here. This is a 10 foot wide by 8 foot tall roll-up door. Of course, we got a standard entry door right here. And on your roll-up doors, your wall height has to be 2 foot higher than whatever height door that you want. So if I wanted a 10 by 10 roll-up door, we would have had to went with 12 foot wall height there. And that would have added to the cost. So we went with 10 foot wall height there on the roll-up door. Just real happy with this. So my plan is to, before I start putting anything in here, I've got some work I'm trying to get done this week, and hopefully this weekend. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pick up some concrete sealer, and I wanna go ahead and get the concrete, get some sealer down here, get that dry. And then I found a guy over in Mobile that deals with bulk shelving, pallet style bulk shelving, because that's what I want to put in there. I want to put pallet you know, heavy duty shelving along that wall and along this wall right there, and have plenty of storage shelves there to put things on. So I found a guy over in Mobile that's got some, that's what he deals in, and I'm gonna strike a deal with him on getting about 20 foot of shelving and walling up two sides over there. So we've got that's gonna go in, and then I gotta figure out, you know, some lighting that's gotta go in here as well. So that's all things that's gonna be in the work. So I'll be working on it a little at the time. I've got machine shop work I gotta get done. I got video work to get done. So I'm happy that we made it this far. Just very, very happy. I'm a happy customer right now. So glad to see this project get done right here.